Celebrate 50 years of our very own Molly Meldrum with maxtv.com.au and discover the defining moments of Molly's story with his interactive timeline spanning his whole career. We're also giving away one authentic Molly Meldrum hat, autographed by the legend himself. Just head to maxtv.com.au to enter.
Countdown, and particularly Molly, was just madness. I mean, you know, when I first came down to Australia without knowing what had hit me, I mean, it was just mad and chaos. And they said, you've got to do this show.
It was like Top of the Pops, but like in England, which is the key show, but it was more fun. You know, it wasn't all this, you know, messing about with the unionised thing, and it was real fun. It was really colourful.
The ABC had never been used to a show like that. It was originally recorded on Fridays. I think they moved it to Saturdays to cause less havoc within the ABC.
The green room in between acts and stuff was just... I wish you'd have had a camera in there then, because that was the true story. It was extraordinary.
There were certain rock and roll outfits that would take it a little bit too far every now and again, but, nah, it was good fun. It was all good, clean fun. Well, maybe sometimes not so clean, but it was all good fun.
And sometimes there were absolute blues and blunders and wrong things said and, oh, my goodness, you know, so everything was chaos then, you know. You had to sort of stop and restart and do the thing and, oh.
And Molly was the driver of it. He was the lunatic. And, you know, it was arty and gay and it was crazy, the arguments and fights.
You'd hear doors slamming down the corridors of ABC, and Michael Shrimpton, Robbie Weeks and Molly and Grant Rule would be yelling at each other down the hallway.
It depended who was directing that week, and it would also depend on which record company person had the number one that week or who was trying to get a new video clip on that was otherwise not going to be seen or heard or, you know.
And the VIP room was full of, like, Joe Cocker, all these people, right? And all of a sudden the doors of the VIP room would burst open and they'd be yelling at each other, and Molly would be saying, I want them on the show. And Shrimpton would say, you can't have them on the show.
And at that point, I think Molly was always the winner. 99.9% of the time, poor Grant Rule, poor Tony, poor any of those guys, they wouldn't win. Because he knew what he wanted and he knew what music's strength was and he knew what visually would work. And he was always right.
Everybody loved him for what he did because, I mean, he was enjoyable to be with. He was fun. He was mad, you know, and it was one of those things. But he was a handful.
It's hard to go past Iggy Pop on Countdown. He was just, like, totally out of control and loving it, and Molly's just sort of trying to rein him in.
One album.
Hiya, dog face.
Iggy, how are you, mate? Listen,
good day.
To the show.
No, he is one of those characters that is outrageous, very talented, and he was just in one of those outrageous moves.
A couple of years ago, was with Iggy. Will you concentrate on the question?
Suddenly, Molly was trying to be the serious straight guy and being like, come on, Iggy, get it together, take this seriously. And Iggy's jumping around, calling him dog face and slapping him. Rehearsal was fine. Iggy was fine. But then whatever happened between rehearsal and showtime, who knows? And suddenly Iggy was a different person. And all the camera shots that they'd rehearsed, if you look back at that clip, suddenly the camera's here, but Iggy's over here, and then he's jumping here. It was just total mayhem.
You just can't imagine that happening, you know, at 6:30 on a Sunday night. You know, I can imagine the kids at home after having wrestled the remote off their father who wanted to watch the Channel 9 news, you know, and then Dad having to sit there and watch that go on. Must have been unreal.
And now we come to the most important part of the... Could I just have one glass of water, please? No. I'm terribly sorry about this.
It doesn't?
Prince Charles, that interview. It was grade A embarrassing, really.
Your Royal Highness, it is a pleasure to have you here to help us support the Queen's Silver Jubilee Appeal for Young Australians.
I'm delighted to be here, obviously, as the patron.
How did Prince Charles end up on a pop music show in Australia? It was quite bizarre. But what happened, it was the Queen's Silver Jubilee celebrations. Prince Charles was touring Australia as part of all of that. So Harry and Miller, who was the chairman of the organising committee, came to Michael Shrimpton and Molly and said, we want Prince Charles to come on Countdown. He'll do an interview with Molly. And Michael Shrimpton was like, oh, my God, this is a recipe for disaster.
I'm not very good particularly with working with scripts, then.
No, not good. I mean, I don't do one script either.
No.
I'm not going to give you scripted answers.
Right.
And if I can't do that. I just
watched Molly transform, you know, like he just turned into an English person. Oh, I'm terribly sorry. that was just wonderful when Charles said, don't you have one of those teleprompter things? And I think his answer was, no, this is the ABC.
Well, that was a very strange week and weeks preceding that, because I've been overseas doing interviews in America and England and God knows where.
He had done 54 interviews in 19 days. It was a crazy trip. He'd had a punch-up with Johnny Rotten.
He flicked a cigarette. I don't know whether it was at me, but it actually hit my camera in the eye, so I jumped over the table and knocked Johnny out. And Sid got up and applauded.
He was hanging out with Rod Stewart, Crazy Times in New York. He was dancing with Stevie Nicks. He saw John Lennon, which was the last time he ever saw John Lennon. It was interviewed Billy Idol for the first time. Delayed the return home, of course, to do one more interview with Queen.
And then, unfortunately, the flights back to Melbourne were booked out. So we had to go via LA to get back. And so I got back only the day before the interview with Prince Charles. Very nervous because I was always brought up through my mother and my grandmother as a royalist to some degree. And then, you know, it was difficult, you know.
Some months ago, we had a talk with Mr. Harry M. Miller, chairman of the Silver Jubilee organisation. Oh, no, is that right? Well, after a lot of negotiation, we are launching the Countdown Silver Jubilee Australian Top 20 album. Oh, no.
I mean, how many takes did he do of that? I mean, I think we've all seen 6 or 7 takes of him trying to get it together and him patting him on the knee and saying, it's all right, lovey. You know, yeah, pure gold.
The profits from which will be donated to the Queen's Silver Jubilee organisation. Oh,
God, what is he doing? This is disgraceful. That's the king in waiting. You know.
And I did say during a break, oh, he said, I believe you just came back from England. And I said, yes, I was in London, actually. And I said, actually, I saw your mum driving on a carriage the other day to open Westminster. And he looked at me and went, do you mean Her Majesty the Queen? Oh, no.
At that stage, he'd met John Lennon, all the big rock stars in the world, but meeting royalty was something quite amazing. So then suddenly to be interviewing the future King of England, it was just too much for him.
But, of course, he's a pretty canny guy, Charles. He moved with the interview. If you see it and you watch it, he kind of develops it and gets Molly out of jail about 50 times. It's a wonderful piece of television.
That was part of the magic of music television and being part of Countdown. That was magic. Even when Cole Chisel trashed the setup for the TV Week Music Awards that we did, it was great television.
Everybody thinks much more about this than Cole Chisel actually did. We were after years of being on Countdown and years of getting up at 7 in the morning, going to the ABC and bloody, you know, going rehearsals and being stuck there in stupid sets, you know, where they were making us look like we're sitting playing chess or something. And, whatever they do for us. We just, you know, we knew that we put East out. We knew we were going to win like a lot of awards on there. I think there was 12 awards or something. We won 9. And we knew we were going to win a lot. So we decided, right, this is our chance. We're going to put our foot down and tell them what we think. So we told them we were going to do My Turn to Cry, which is a song I wrote for East. It was the East album was the big album, obviously. And we secretly went into the rehearsal studio and rewrote this other section of the song where it comes to the middle and where it breaks down, and we go into this stuff, this rant about, you know, well, I never saw you when I was starving at the Largesby Hotel. I never seen you here. You know, up, eat this, basically, was the punchline. And we knew that if we gave it away, if we walked in with sort of shitty-looking guitars and stuff, it'd be a dead giveaway. So we actually bought shitty-looking guitars and put Fender transfers on them and done them up so that they would so they wouldn't catch on that we were up to something. The idea was just to smash up the set. That was our plan. Get to the middle of the song and go nuts, smash up the set. Make a little statement, have a laugh and leave. And we were like a bunch of school kids. We were just laughing our heads off. And, you know, we had our own party. We boycotted the party. And at the end of the party, you know, about 3 o'clock in the morning, Molly turned up pissed and said, oh, you guys, you know. Come on in, Molly. It's all right, mate.
And I thought they were happy to receive the awards.
In its time, Countdown was sort of regarded with a certain amount of... Musicians were either friends of Countdown or they weren't, you know. It really polarised the music community.
You know, you've got to remember, Australian rock and roll bands cut their teeth playing live. We played live and we played in sweaty pubs. It was uncompromising. It was raw. And then, you know, there wasn't a lot of TV. That we didn't do a lot of TV. A lot of bands from overseas were used to doing TV where you got up and you mimed. And bands like Cultures and the Oils, we couldn't... Why would we want to mime, you know?
I mean, the Midnight Oil story is a really fascinating one with Countdown.
Is anyone interested in this story?
I'm not sure. Molly, really interested. He wants to know whether it's the same story that he tells.
I can't remember.
We didn't do it.
We're absolutely certain about that.
But we nearly did it. It's the truth.
But we didn't do it.
Yeah.
One story goes that the band wanted their own lighting guy, they wanted their own sound guy to work on their number for Countdown. And, of course, at the ABC... That's not how it works. They've got their own people doing all of that.
But these blokes took it pretty seriously, and I guess the ABC didn't realise what it was creating, but they certainly had strong rules. They certainly tried to dictate to acts what was going on sometimes.
And Michael Shrimpton, who great TV maker, he had said, look, I'm sick of these rock bands turning up late. We're making TV. Time is money. We've got a whole crew waiting here. The next band that turns up late, they're off the show. Unfortunately, the next band to turn up late was Midnight Oil. Their manager, Gary Morris, went to the studio and said, look, hope it's okay. The band's running a bit late. They'll be here soon. And Ted Emery just said, you're off the show. And credit to Gary Morris. He just said, well, stuff you and your show. We will never do this silly pop show. And that's it. We're out of here. And they really wore that as a badge of honour. But I know that that really hurt Molly over the years because he loved Midnight Oil and they're one of the greatest rock bands of all time. And so, yeah, it was really disappointing for him that they never did the show and that they would bag the show.
In retrospect, I just think now I look back on all of the controversy that connected with it, especially with regard to the view members of Hunters and Collectors had towards it. And I actually think it just doesn't matter. You know, I just think, you know, any public exposure on television is a good thing. I mean, we just don't have anything like that now that serves what Countdown did for the industry.
Countdown should have never finished. I mean, it was so important.
Yeah, it was a sad day, but I think it the writing was on the wall for some time, you know.
Unfortunately, something which Countdown helped to create, the music video, ultimately kind of killed Countdown.
The dream run had come to an end. Video killed the radio star, video shows killed Countdown.
It was disaster, because it wasn't only so much us, because by then we had established our careers, but it was all the guys that were coming up behind us. What the hell were they supposed to do? There was no way they were going to be able to compete with all the overseas amazing video clips and stuff that were coming out, you know. Michael Jackson doing his best. And it's like, how do we compete with that? They cost $1 zillion and we're making a cracker here.
Everybody had a film clip. Whereas at the start, you know, ABBA got on because they had a film clip and Bohemian Rhapsody was huge because there was a film clip. So, you know, they had to put lots of Australian bands on because they didn't have the film clips to do an hour show. Towards the end, they could have made a three-hour show with film clips and not even used an Australian act if they wanted to.
The magic of Countdown was the three live acts that we and the Australian acts or international acts that we could push, but they were live in the studio with one of them hosting or co-hosting with Ian. And that was the magic of Countdown.
And in the mid-'80s, they tried to reinvent it a couple of times. Ratings went down, and it was a tough time. And I think Molly was kind of tired. He'd been doing the show for 13 years.
We'd have to beg and borrow and steal, you know, to, fund trips overseas and all of that, you know. It was just becoming really too hard, you know. And I just couldn't battle with Harak anymore, you know. From Sydney and the bosses and all that, you know.
His passion for music didn't die in any way, but the Australian music industry lost out and the international artists lost out when Countdown went.
But they went out with a bang, and with the Countdown Awards that year, and Molly organised a train trip from Melbourne to Sydney. I mean, it was just madness. But the show was a wonderful celebration of 13 years.
I remember John Farnham being the first on for the first edition, and I remember him being on the last show. I mean, what an extraordinary achievement that was. I mean, John went through that whole period of time. He went from black and white to colour.
I think it's evident to everyone. Ian Meldrum is a music fan, which is more important than everything.
And then with that great reveal, Molly taking off the hat and the bald head, which was a total secret to everyone. He'd given Michael Shrimpton a lock of hair with a note saying, do not open this till the end of the show. Michael had no idea what was going on. No one did. It was just another magical TV moment that Molly created. And maybe if they'd hung in there a little bit longer, things could have been different. Kylie co-hosted the second last Countdown, the studio Countdown. So she was just emerging as a huge pop act. Maybe if they'd hung in, all of that sort of those new pop artists would have helped to have another wave of Countdown.
Good night, Australia. And thanks for 13 years. You've been bloody wonderful.
I mean, television, as much as I did it, it didn't excite me. When I say excite me, I just didn't see my role in television. I thought I looked terrible on television. I thought my delivery was terrible. And there were much better people that could do that rather than me, you know? I loved the times, you know, when I could just be in the background. That's why I love being in a recording studio, in the control room, and the mixing rooms, because it was nurturing the talent of someone else, you know?
After Countdown, Molly kind of wanted a break, but he also wanted to really promote Australian music still, and he just felt that pop music didn't get a fair run on radio and record companies weren't signing enough pop artist. It was still the days of pub rock.
I was listening to a lot of demo tapes through the Countdown period, and I spoke to Michael about it as a Kandinsky, and he said, well, let's start a label.
And he needed people to do all the operating side of things. Molly could A&R, Molly could style to a certain way. Molly could, have visions and ideas and career planning, but so it was a good combination.
And we had to come up with a label name and toured around, and Melodium was always like a musical name anyway. And I thought, Melodium, like M-E-L-O-D, then I-A-N. And that's how we called it, Melodium.
Molly found the talent in Melodium. Molly was to the record label exactly what he was to the Australian public and the television industry. He was the sourcer, the diviner, if you want, of talent. You know, maybe that's a good word for him. Molly Meldrum is the diviner of talent.
It wasn't about money to Molly. It was about helping artists, about him learning more and more about the studio and about finding new talent.
And they signed a band from Queensland, Indecent Obsession.
Indecent Obsession was a huge act overseas. It only ever had a couple of hits in Australia, but internationally they toured for, I think, 4, 5, 6 years we were away. And then a young girl from Melbourne called Joanne Guilfoyle. And Joanne Guilfoyle was a wannabe backing singer who I decided to name Jo Beth Taylor because I thought the name Joanne Guilfoyle sounded like she came from a supermarket. And I remember Molly saying to me, why Jo Beth Taylor? And I said, oh, because we're just going to pretend she's the illegitimate love child of Elizabeth Taylor. And he went, righto.
And then with after Jo, then Peter Andre.
I stop and stare at you walking on the shore. I try to concentrate. My mind wants to explore.
We had on Channel 9 a remake of the show New Faces with Daryl Summers hosting it. And he was one of the contestants.
And he was doing a fabulous Michael Jackson routine, which he was so influenced by Michael Jackson at that time. And Molly thought, this boy's really good.
And then I told Daryl, I think he's got a great potential, wouldn't mind signing him to my label. And Daryl, God bless him, said it on television to Peter. He said, talk to Molly because he's going to sign you up to the label.
I mean, Peter Andre has had number one singles and albums in the UK. Melodeon had a lot of success, and that, you know, that was Molly Meldrum driving it.
That song was Mysterious Boy, not Mysterious Girl. Molly changed that lyric. It didn't get any credit for it. Didn't want any credit for it at the time. And he when he got behind something, he loved it.
Melodeon, I think, struck a chord from that point of view that we had just young acts. Then we changed focus away from pop a bit and did Roxas.
You don't work with Molly without there being drama somewhere. What you hope is that the drama doesn't directly involve you and Molly, but it often did.
When we're in Rhinoceros Studios with Mark Opitz recording the album, we recorded the single and everyone was intensely waiting for the process to be done so that we could, in those days, get a cassette down to Ian so he could hear it. So, you know, we've worked hard, we've recorded well, we've really been doing our thing and, you know, we want Molly to like it. So he ends up getting a copy of the cassette. We're in Sydney, he's in Melbourne. The phone rings at the studio, I say, hello. He says, Juno, it's Ian. I said, what do you think of the single? He said, it's fucking shit.
It's not fair to say it's Molly's way or the highway, but Molly knows best. He does know what's right, and he's got that innate sense of talent. And so you would never have wanted to put him with an artist, let's say, like Deborah Conway. I mean, they would have killed each other.
Look, it got tough. He expected everything now. He wanted everything done yesterday. You drop all your other artists. I remember I was managing Jimmy Barnes at the time. We had the Melodeon launch, and Jimmy was doing a big sold-out pub gig, and I didn't turn up to the launch.
You know, Molly and his style got himself in a bit of a tiz and got wound up into a frenzy, you know, drank himself into a frenzy and decided... Michael's house in Turex got a big wall around it, so Molly decides at 3 a.m. he's going to jump the wall and come and tell Michael what he thinks of him.
I was already in bed, and I'd had a bit of a booze night with Jimmy, who was sleeping at the back of the house with headphones on, thank God. So Jane Barnes and Sue yell upstairs, look, this is getting ugly, you better come downstairs. So that's when I blew up.
So Michael comes down, and Michael, you know, just starts ranting, and the two of them are in the kitchen, and I think Michael got so irate that he rammed Molly's head into the microwave.
As I was grabbing him, my wife turned to me and she goes, stop it, he's enjoying it.
And I'm still asleep at this point, but Jane's really terrified he's going to wake me because I'll just wake up and punch him out, you see. I don't like getting woken up in the middle of the night, but especially by drunk people. So Molly comes back and there's one more thing, and finally Jane goes, oh, bugger it. She went smack and knocked him on his ass.
He was a bit sort of sorry, but Molly could take that sort of stuff and drop it. You know, it was all over. It was done. It was but he can be a cheeky, cheeky troublemaker.
Do I believe that music has a purpose in life? Of course I do. Because I think music is universal. And the fact is that Every people relate some song or music to their own lives, be it with relationships or highlights, even dramas. So I think it's very important. People ask me, am I grateful about music and coming into my life? I think ABBA sang it beautifully and summed it up when they sang Thank You for the Music. I'm very grateful for it.
Max is celebrating Molly Meldrum, 50 years in the biz. This December, only on Max, where music lives.
As written. There was a second thing to me doing television, really. I really wasn't always comfortable with it, but as Red Simon says, with someone that never wanted to be on television, then, boy, something either horribly went right or something horribly went wrong.
He was old mates with Gavin Disney. Gavin Disney was one of the bosses of Go Set magazine back in the 70s, so he knew Molly from then. And Gavin Disney at that point was the executive producer of Hey Hey It's Saturday. And he was trying to convince Molly to go on the show as their music reporter.
And we'd had our own pop segment, and we used to use Gavin Wood, ironically, the voice of Countdown. And Molly was available, and there didn't seem to be anything that he was rushed into, and I thought, we really should use Moll. We should get him over and use him, and I think it would be good for him and it would be good for our show.
Gavin Disney rang me and said, look, we want to take you to lunch. Come to lunch with us. I said, well, OK. So I went out and we went down to St Kilda to a restaurant down there, and all the crew were there, and Red and Willie and all. So this is a big one. And then... Gavin got up and announced, you know, the whole new season for 1998 for Hey Hey, and said this and that and that, and he said, and we've got an extra cast member, and Molly, come up here. Huh?
And he announced our new music guru for 1988 is Molly Meldrum.
And I could have killed him. I went, what the hell is this all about?
And a man in the hat is here, Molly's Melodrama!
When he did come on board, it was, from his point of view, it was, how do I fit into this unique little ecosystem called Hey Hey It's Saturday, where you've got, you know, these voices coming from above, you've got sound effects, you've got little supers, bottom of screen crawling across, you've got cartoons happening, and the director will take those at random. So it was, and you've got sundry others who are going to interrupt.
Next Saturday,
yes.
I'm off overseas again to New York, right?
Again?
Mr. Meldrum.
Yes?
We've got a shot of inside your duodenum on the back screen there.
Nothing
you want to have that
nothing
seat?
Nothing of the sort. It's my spa, actually.
Oh, is it right?
Yes.
Oh, right.
It's my spa, yes.
Right, remind me never to go swimming in it.
Right.
He was perfect for that show because, you know, like Daryl didn't know what the hell he was doing. Daryl would be there going, OK, we're going to funny photos now. What? No, no, commercial? OK, we're going to commercial. No, no, what? We are doing funny photos. Oh, no, we're doing readers' letters. Like Daryl did it for 18 years and he didn't know what the hell was going on. So, you know, Molly in there in the mix as well was, it's a mess anyway. Let's just chuck Molly in to really mess it up.
And it was a great part of Hey Hey. And everyone, really everyone loved Molly, because he was easygoing and he would take a lot of flack, and Red and Willie and Russell and all the guys, and John, of course, John Blackman, would always have fun, often at Molly's expense. Sling.
Then I got together with Boy George.
Oh!
Oh, yeah. And watch out for the 12-inch, because it's...
I have to be blunt here, and it used to piss me off how much they made fun of his sexuality. It's just annoyed the shit out of me, and still does to this day.
At times, I would go to John Blackman, what have you just said?
Before I go on, I meant to do this last week. Bruce Springsteen has got these two albums out now, Lucky Town and
Hold
Human
them still.
Touch. All right, please, it's my segment.
John can be very cutting, John Blackman. But Ian, you know, he's got
a hide as thick as a rhino, say, and he's been around long enough to be able to take all that sort of stuff.
It's not as if he didn't play up to it himself. He loved it, and any chance he got, he'd pop out that he's, you know, the queen of sorts or something. So, you know, professionally commendable to play up to it in that way, I think.
And people thought that John and I hated each other. We were the best of mates, you know. But at times, when we went too far, and we'd have, like, drinks after the party, what's like a party, with Hey Hey, back in the Summers Carol offices. At times, I was ready to kill John. I said, this is not on, John. This is ridiculous, you know.
Because the show was generally a comedy show, I mean, he'd be lucky to finish his sentence without, you know, somebody interrupting or some gag going off.
And it's number three now in the UK.
That looks like a silicone implant gone wrong.
Don't worry about it.
Probably one of the hardest things ever was trying to contain Molly's melodrama into one segment, because he had a ton of stuff that he wanted to get out on behalf of the record companies, and in between there was, hey, g'day, Mr. Meldrum. Up Dickie would pop and do lines on Molly, and then Molly would answer Dickie, and other things would happen. It was a show within a segment.
Everyone should go to Vancouver. It's fantastic. It really is a truly great city.
Is that where the Niagara Falls are?
No, it's the other side of Canada.
Oh, right, sorry.
I wish you'd go on the Niagara Falls, I'll tell you right now. Anyway,
I attempted one time to review an album, and I'd have these albums in front of me going this and this and that, and it was an album from EMI, and every time I pick it up, and it wasn't the fault of John, I'd be interrupted by Dickie Knee, and I'd put that down, and then I'd get back to the flow. I'd then go... And for 4 weeks in a row, they'd missed the review of the album.
It must have been frustrating for Molly, and it was frustrating for bands, because you know that he'd be holding your album in his hands, trying to talk about it, and being diverted every 5 seconds to a gag. And then sometimes not coming back to it, and just putting it down and then going, anyway. and then you've missed your chance.
So we had to bring in a sort of an unofficial rule that we don't tell the record companies what's going to be on that week, you know, because then they won't have the expectation.
I think everyone realises the power and the importance of Countdown to the Australian music industry. I don't think a lot of people recognise just how significant Hey Hey It's Saturday was, and it was only when it was gone that we realised that.
Well, Hey Hey It's Saturday was really important, because it was... you know, one of the only opportunities for a band to play live on national television, and not mime, you know, not play to a backing track, but actually, you know, they would accommodate a completely live band. And of all different styles, and, you know, Hey Hey It's Saturday used to have, you know, pop acts, but also metal bands, and, you know.
And Molly knew that. He knew it was such an important outlet for music. And Molly is like an evangelist for pop music. It's not fame for himself, it's fame. He loves other people's success and he wants to share in it.
When he was on Melodrama, if we had a single out, you know, 9 times out of 10, if Molly held it up, it meant that we went up 30 positions in the chart, or, you know, it was immediate impact.
The power of it was it's such a broad entertainment show. So it wasn't just music fans tuning in, but people would be tuning in and they would find out what was going on in the music world via Molly. They'd always have about 4 live acts on every week. So people were getting to see music in prime time. We just don't get to see that nowadays.
It was so much fun with everyone, you know. We were like a big family, again a team. We became a team, and so, as I said, I've been so used to teams at Go Set, teams of Countdown, and now another team, you know?
Okay, well, I'm going now.
You're gone years ago.
Molly, you can't go out. You can't go out on a low
Molly,
like that.
Molly, you've come back. Come That's Uru from the Guru.
The great thing is that doing Hey Hey, was just down the road. in Bendigo Street in Richmond, and House being here, and then doing stuff for Foxtel, be it Channel V and then MTV and that we could have artists rehearsing at Hey Hey for their thing, then coming here and doing interviews for that, and then going back there, and so we had people like it was a green room going mad from there to there to there to there to there to there, you know. Well, Puff, welcome to the house, but welcome more importantly to Australia.
Yeah.
Well, Dave, welcome to the house.
Thank you.
And welcome to the show. Well, Melissa, Eric, Sam, and Courtney, welcome to the house. As promised, one of my favourites. How are you?
Good, how are you?
In the backyard. I always get nervous when I do interviews, still to this day.
So nervous doing this.
Oh, no.
Over the last week, I've had no sleep thinking about the Michael Jackson thing.
Oh. No one in the world interviewed Michael Jackson more than Molly. That's amazing. He met him in 1973 when the Jackson 5 toured Australia, interviewed him in 1977, insisted on interviewing him when he was on a Countdown trip. The record company wasn't interested. CBS actually said to him, "This guy is not a priority for our label, so don't waste your time interviewing him." Molly insisted on interviewing Michael Jackson. Did that interview then, and then interview him all the way up to his death. I mean, it was remarkable, just that one relationship that Molly had, you know, with the King of Pop.
I think Ian Meldrum could talk to anybody, and if he and people see the passion.
I think that's why a lot of big artists are taken to him. They think this guy's the real deal. He's not just trying to get runs on the board or, you know, big note himself by, you know, he's the guy who interviewed Madonna. It's not about that for Molly. He just loves his work. And I think they sense that.
Hi, Molly.
Hi, Lovie. How are you?
Good.
In particular, his interviews with Elton John are always really fascinating to watch because they seem to have a great friendship and there seems to be a great amount of trust between them. And Molly interviewing Elton, I've seen various ones from over the years, but Elton seems to open up to him in this really almost raw kind of way, and it's really like watching two old friends talking.
All right, let's get on to the big picture.
Yes, indeed.
All right.
Which one, the Titanic?
No.
I'm going to pornography after that. I'm starting to make pornography movies.
Getting out nude and doing all
yeah,
that,
that's
you
it.
Know?
The nude pornography. Everything on MTV in the future is going to be nude.
But so Elton and I have a great friendship, and sometimes he sends me up gutless. Like, you know, we came here one time for a party here, for a barbecue here, with his mum, Sheila, and John Reed, and whatever. And he walked outside and looked at the pool, and he said, "Oh, that's a lovely spa. Where's the pool?" I was ready to kill him.
Look, it's a rare thing for, let's call him a journalist, an interviewer, to be treated, you know, to be thought of by all the artists as an equal. And I don't mean that in any funny way, but usually we're on our guard because people ask us questions. They might want to pry into our private lives. They might want to kind of like say your last album was shit, and they might not be in there for all the support reasons that we want them to be. But it's nice when they become close. And I've got to say, Molly only ever asked positive questions. You know, it was positive and creative, constructive, you know. So he was one of us. I think we all trusted him, and that's why he got closer.
Well, it's amazing the respect that he's built over many years. He's earned a wonderful reputation with these people. He has this gift to be able to unpack them, and they can suddenly tell Molly their life story.
I don't know, because I'd dread when he'd interview me, because he'd sort of say things like, "So, okay, you're going to behave tonight? All right, okay, because you're a naughty thing. Now, you've got your new album out, and it's produced by Kevin Beamish, and you know, you've been touring the band and it's all good, and you've got the new film clip out, so how are you?" And you go, "I'm good."
Often artists have turned the table around on him because they either didn't understand the question or didn't perceive that there was one in the first place. So that used to happen quite frequently with Molly. He'd had all the information there, but he would actually, in posing the question, he would often answer the question as well. So really, he didn't need the artists at all.
You know, he's a very smart guy, but
It just, there's too much going on in the head for the mouth to keep up with.
He knows more about the artist than they know about themselves.
All right, with the song itself, with your songwriting, I mean, do you write a song and sometimes just put it aside and then you take parts of that song and make it into another song, like with Born to Run?
I'm trying to think. I'm not sure how that song came. I know that song came about very slowly.
Well, the Violent Ones, a song called The Violent Ones, seemed to have parts of Born to Run in it.
Really?
Yeah.
Who did the record?
Yourself. I mean, there was a song called The Violent Ones that you did.
You're kidding me. No. I don't remember it.
Yeah.
Well, I'd like to hear it. It's a good title. I'd like to hear it.
You know, so much kind of negative or humorous attitude was directed towards him for his umming and ahhing and him getting excited and all of that. But to me, that was what his charm was and why he's lasted so long, because he always puts the star first. He's genuinely in awe of the people that he interviews, you know.
What Molly is Molly is that fan that's got a chance to sneak in backstage without a pass and actually get to talk to your Elton John or your Eric Clapton or your Phil Collins or your Beyonce. He's that guy, that person that you want to be interviewing that star. That's his appeal.
With me, with my interviews, if you call them interviews, I just have conversations with them, and I'm not a tabloid journalist or anything like that, you know? So they feel at ease, and, you know, a lot of them have been right here at this house.
Well, I think it says a lot about him that he brings people to his home, he does his interviews from his home, so you're welcomed into that world. And I remember thinking, whoa, he's got a second career as an interior decorator, because it's crazy in there.
The first time you see it, it's like, wow, like this, you know, this exists behind this kind of regular suburban wall. It's like this other world.
It was like being backstage with the props, you know, in a movie set. It was a little bit like that. I always found that to be very strange, and he wouldn't bat an eyebrow at it. He'd just be sitting there interviewing, you're sort of trying to keep a straight face, and behind him, you know, some rabbit walks past or something random, and that always stuck with me as, you know, the craziness of his lifestyle.
When you're in a studio and you go to a studio, you feel very conscious that you're in a studio and you're doing work and it's television or anything like that. If you do it around a house and all that, it's really like a barbecue. It's fantastic. Sometimes we're partied too hard. No, a lot of times we're partied too hard.
Imagine it.
In fact, the whole fucking thing's been a party.
The parties were, you know, really, really good. I can't tell you too much about them, but they were really, really, you know, they were out of control.
Do you want a drum?
Bacchanalian things going on at Molly's house. Yeah, there were huge parties.
Because the house was just designed for parties. And from the pool room to the spa room to the pool, and the number of times people have fallen or been pushed into that pool, I couldn't count.
He had a party in the 80s where Lauren Bacall, Bob Dylan, Tom Petty, Cyndi Lauper and Stevie Nicks, they were all at the same party. And Mark Knopfler from Dire Straits. That's incredible.
You know, I remember years ago going to his house and there was a party and there was people everywhere, and I said, who are these people? And he said, oh, I don't know, lovey, get yourself a drink.
There would have been people from his local supermarket, just a taxi driver that he'd met the night before, you've got to come to my party.
You know, and he's like that to this day, you know, he's just so giving and so outgoing. He really does love people.
David Dixon. We're here at Molly Meldrum's house having a bit of a party. Tonight on the drum, we got Peter Andre. Oh, jeez. We got Peter Andre. Through the room. Past to present.
Take two. Sorry, I should have more.
Molly Meldrum. Doctors say he's fighting for his life after an accident at his home last night. The music figure has had surgery and is still in a coma. It's believed he was putting up Christmas decorations at his home when he fell and hit his head.
Bloody hell, you know, I mean, putting up your Christmas lights and falling off the ladder. I mean, for fuck's sake.
Oh, Molly, you know, you idiot, what were you doing up on a bloody ladder? You probably had a couple, and then all of a sudden, you know, oh, my God.
But knowing what he's like, you know, yeah... everyone's gone and everything. Oh, look, I'll give it a go, you know, hang up these trizzy bloody Christmas decorations. It's so typical of him. He's impatient. He wants it yesterday.
And it reminded me of the thing that no one over 60 should ever climb a ladder, change a light bulb, which is a rule in our house.
It was tragic. I mean, it was serious fall.
And my heart just sank. And we didn't think he was going to make it through the night. I mean, that first night, those first couple of days, it seriously did look like he wasn't going to make it.
And I was out of it for 5 weeks, and then when I came to, and then the dawning thing of the response from the Australian public and the press, and that was really a lot to cope with, you know. Very flattering in that, but I didn't know how to handle that, you know.
We all had that moment where we thought, wait a minute, what if we lose Molly Meldrum, this person who is so inherently like a part of the furniture here on television in this country? What if that's taken away from us? And I think that made us value him again.
I think anything that happens, especially when you hear it through the media, to somebody that you know and care about, it's always, of course, it was of great concern to all of us, to everybody that knows him and doesn't know him.
Prime Minister Gillard was sending him get well cards. The Premier of Victoria at the time dropped in to see him. So it was all of those people and all around the world, you know, people, you know, Beyonce was saying to her record company, how's Molly? So it was all the famous people. But what was really incredible was it was just everyday people, everyone. It showed just the power of Countdown and Hey Hey It's Saturday. It was all ages.
You know, if we were going to think in Australia about how many icons we've got in media or music or writers, journalists in general, name them. You know, the first name you come up with is Molly Meldrum, and that spans generations now. So it wasn't surprising that that public outpouring of grief came. He's as well known and loved in the sporting industry as he is in the music industry, so it's not like he's just this one guy who used to sit on TV every Sunday night at 6 o'clock and tell you what record to buy, you know?
I think there was a lot of people saying that he wouldn't make it, you know, or that he would, if he came out the other side, he would barely be himself.
I knew his determination would pull him through. Obviously, he had excellent care, but at the end, I mean, I heard that he was up and dressed when he knew that he was going to go home soon, but he was up and dressed and wanted to go to the footy, and went. Can you imagine? Ian, no, haven't been released. Yeah, right, I'll do that later, lovey. God.
So he went on the run, and they found him down in Church Road and Church Street in Richmond, and they said, you've got to come back to the hospital. And he said, no, I'm not, so I'm going home. They said, and you have to come. He said, force me. So he went home, and that was it.
And I was a bit scared to ring him, but I did. And I nearly broke down when he answered the phone because he sounded exactly the same. And I didn't know what to expect. I just, you know, I did not know what to expect.
I think his rehabilitation was phenomenal. Surprising and phenomenal.
Physically, he's in a bit of trouble, you know, like he did come down, you know, you've heard of people hitting the tiles, but he hit the tiles really hard, you know, and but, you know, up here is spot on, you know, he still remembers more about life than I ever will.
You know, it wasn't great that he had the accident, but I think it showed just how special he is to Australia and Australians, and it, you know, don't take this guy for granted. Celebrate the history, but and still celebrate what he's doing now, which is promoting Australian music. And yeah, thank God we've still got Molly Meldrum.
There is always some part of his life that there is some drama going on.
No. Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Well, he punched one of the producers and he thumped one of the others, and he was getting a bit, you know, a bit out of control, and that was the day I had him arrested. Watch that sea.
It was a crowded party,
And all of a sudden he's behind me and I hear this voice saying, you know, you're going to have to fucking work hard to pay back the money that you wasted on that single. And it was on.
Oh, there was one. There was one particular fight I had with him once, and Molly was disrespectful about our ratings win. And I remember flying for him, and we end up having this monstrous argument, fingers pointing at each other. It spilled out into the street, and in the middle of the tram tracks, we're still shouting at each other.
One night, him and I got made up by a couple of his lay girls, friends with all the lay girls stuff, like showgirls, and we went to a massage parlour in Moray Street, and because we knew the owner, and pretended that we were prostitutes.
I will tell you the story, but this is between Molly and I. So when you see this, Molly, you know that I'm talking about you and I. So it happened to be after a Mardi Gras, and Molly and I found ourselves in one another's company, and it was a great day. That's all I'll say.
I remember that he used to get off the plane from Australia to come into LA to work. And of course, he'd detour past my place in West Hollywood. And I'd have a roast ready and waiting for him as he got off the plane. So, because he loved his lamb roast, so I'd make him a really lovely lamb roast with baked vegetables and stuff and potatoes. And he'd come, eat, and then go.
I remember the first time that I ever met Molly, and he was so lovely, and he came over and had a chat with me. And I walked away from it thinking, what a really lovely guy. And about 2 weeks later, I saw him again at an event, and I went up to him to say, hi, Molly, how are you? And he looked at me like he'd never seen me before.
Here he is bopping along. I'm playing the song. He's dancing. And I noticed this huge hole in his crutch. I said, Molly. And he looks down and he says, oh, my God. And I thought he was going to say, I've got to go or whatever. Instead, he says, can I borrow some briefs? I said, sure. And he said, don't worry, I'll bring them back next week. I said, not necessary.
He'd mostly say the same thing to me, that we should mostly both grow up a little bit and look after ourselves a bit better. Have that of a gentler way of putting it to you, Ian. We want to see you around a long time. Australia loves you. What you've done for Australia will never be forgotten in the annals. But stay strong.